And it's my pleasure to introduce our first speaker, who is Sergii Pakhomenko. Professor Pakhomenko is Associate Professor of Political Science and International Relations at Mariupol State University, currently displaced to Kyiv. And he also has an affiliation at the University of Latvia. Dr. Pakhomenko teaches courses in the politics of memory, the theory and practice of nationalism, regional and country studies, information warfare, and PR, propaganda, and political advertising. And the title of his talk for us today is Unconventional Weapons, Using the History in Russian Aggression Against Ukraine. So, Sergii Pakhomenko, welcome, and the floor is yours.
Thank you, Sarah, for the introduction. Thank you, dear colleagues, for the invitation to this program, to this seminar, and thank you for joining this session. So, it is a great opportunity to share my points of view on this subject. You can see the topic in the title. And firstly, I would like to note the Russian invasion of Ukraine has one remarkable detail. This detail is often underestimated or simply not understood in the West. What is this detail? You can see it in my first slide, in the title or in this bright quote from Russian Forum on Information and Psychology Technologies. Look at this quote, please. And it helps understand us how important history for Russian and for Russian action, for Russian actions. In explaining its own aggression or special military operation, so-called, Russia resorts to historical arguments. And from the point of view of the modern Western, maybe post-national world, these arguments are irrational. This is some kind of archaic. Look at this definition: historical lands, ancestors' territories, historical sphere of influence. I don't know, etc., etc., etc. And what are their links, where relations to international law? Nothing in common. But in the eyes of Kremlin, they look weighty. Moreover, I dare say, this is not just some kind of cover-up of other real interests, economic, military, strategic, etc. This is completely irrational neo-imperial desire to restore so-called historical justice. To give it some sort of rationality, we call it neo-imperial. This is one of the sincere goals of the Kremlin in this war. And this to rewrite history, to turn back history, and this implies the destruction of Ukrainian statehood and Ukrainian identity as such. That is why we cannot fully understand the logic of the Kremlin's decisions without taking into account its fixation on history. I mean Putin, I mean Kremlin elites. But the use of history has not started now due to war against Ukraine. Moreover, history was a part of the toolkit with which the current Kremlin regime was built in its various dimensions. First of all, ideological. Though it is actually quite difficult to define the ideology of this regime, This is such an ideological chameleon. Someone calls it authoritarian or totalitarian or even totalitarian regime, but the basic elements are conservative ideas and values. And conservative regimes, as a rule, have especially warm feelings for history, which appears, history appears primarily as a tradition. I would like to my American friends, I would like to recall to my American friends one slogan, make America great again. It is very relevant slogan in current situation in America. Make America great again. The key word is again, not great. I dare to say that keyword is again. This is a turn back to mythical old good days in Russian Zolotoy Vek, golden age. America used to be great, and Mr. Trump gonna bring it back. Without feminists, without LGBT, without migrants, without Latinos, without Chinese power, etc., etc., etc. Old good days. And one thing, that is why Mr. Trump, Mr. Musk get Russian historical arguments. Moreover, they praise them. They praise them. In the Russian case, this is a tradition of statehood, great power, and so-called special path. Therefore, I would like to say that history was used for such fundamental task. I mean, internal Russian politics and external Russian politics as well. The first task, to create homogeneous society loyal to the regime, to the new Russia. But how can it be done in polyethnic state? It is necessary to form and strengthen the political nation, Russians. What has become a unifying symbol in Russia? History, the tradition of Russian statehood with a 1,000-year history. In this case, the experience of Russian Empire and the USSR are combined. One does not prevent the other. The imperial character of both regimes helps their synthesis. Look at the typical scheme, typical official narrative of Russian history, from Kievan Rus to Moscow Tsardom to Russian Empire to USSR and to current Russia. It's not just narrative, it's a canon, it's a canon, it's a dogma, it's a dogma. And it is one of the important features for forming political identity, political and unifying society. One more thing. And important pillar for this unifying is the myth of the great victory in the Second World War. This myth emphasizes the unifying plot and has become a basic element of new Russian identity. The cult of the great victory in Russian memory politics is a separate topic. I will not go into that. There are a number of studies, publications on this topic. I would note the works of Russian historians and political scientists Koposov, Malinova, Ukrainian historian Kasyanov, etc. etc. But I would like to note one interesting thing. I observe this thing. The victory over Nazism justifies everything that Russians are doing now and what they will do in the future. It is such a timeless justification myth, glory myth, myth of justification and glorification at the same time. And one moment, also. I observed some interesting things from everyday practices of self-expression of identity. Usually the outward expression of national identity is traditional ethnic clothing. If we take European nation, when it takes roots in traditional, historical, rural, peasant clothing. Country wear, because nations in Europe were formed in the 19th century, they took traditional folk culture as a symbolic basis. And this culture was rural culture, peasant culture. Look at this slide. Traditional rural costume is a symbol of identity to all nations of the world, almost to all nations of the world, even for American nation, even for American nation. I choose as an example traditional clothing of American cowboys. Okay, but in contrast to it, in Russia, this indicator of national identity is militaristic clothing. Militaristic clothing has become a symbol of national identity. Militaristic clothing from Second World War. Gymnastyorka, so-called gymnastyorka, khaki shirt, a hat with a red star. In fact, national clothes, a symbol of Russianness, not traditional ethnocultural symbols, kasavorotka, shirt, namely the symbols of the Great Patriotic War. It is enough to look at Russian football fans. When we came to the match, when we come to the match, we can see fans from different countries. And they dressed, as a rule, they dressed in ethnic clothes. In Ukraine, this is vyshivanka, so-called vyshivanka. But Russian fans, as a rule, dressed in military clothes from period of Second World War II. Interesting thing. And it seems it proves that myth and cult of great victory became unifying symbol for forming Russian political identity. And we can like it or we cannot like it, this symbol is successful. It works. It works. So the second task to restore, the third task to restore the status of Russia as the great world state. In foreign politics, history is a part of so-called Putin's doctrine. What is this doctrine? Large states have real sovereignty. They have their own spheres of influence, and these spheres are historically conditioned. I would like to recall you. In 2008, at the Bucharest NATO summit, Putin appealed to the lack of historical tradition in Ukraine and the gifts of territories to it. This was the first argument which he provided to express his attitude to the opportunity to opportunity if Ukraine enter NATO, enter NATO. This was the first argument. It was only later than those arguments emerged regarding the security of Russian Federation. In addition, history has been identified as a tool of soft power, of Russian soft power, since 2013. And the second, the next task to commence the creation of the USSR, to restore the historical sphere of Russian influence. All of us remember, it was first in 2005 when Putin said that the collapse of the USSR was the greatest geopolitical catastrophe. But the weird thing is, he wants to revive the USSR, but only without socialism, without union, and without republics. It's really about wanting to restore empire using Soviet nostalgia and sentiments. Consequently, the appeal to history is a part and at the same time tool of the transformation of Kremlin regime. In the case of Ukraine, they see the apogee of this transformation. What place does Ukraine occupy in this worldview? Ukraine does not exist. Ukraine is absent in Russian historical narrative. In the historical frame of the Russian state, Ukraine is present as an integral part. What is the nation according to Russia's view? The nation should have historical tradition of statehood. There was no state in Ukraine, so there was no Ukraine. And it was a part of the Russian state. It is not an ideology. It is not the cover up of some other interest, geopolitical, strategic. It is the base. It is the ground, cornerstone. It is the view of the world. It is a part of historical awareness, civil awareness. There is no Ukraine. And it is not a new idea. This idea has its root in the 18th century, the idea of unified Russian Empire. Ukraine was considered a part of Russia and was called Malo Russia, small Russia. Russian historical narrative is imperialistic, and it was presented in a concentrated form in Putin's article. You remember in 2021 on the historical unity of Russians and Ukrainians. Historical unity of Russian and Ukrainian. Its main message were absence of national traditions of state, artificiality of the very idea of the Ukrainian state invented either by the Poles or the Austrians in the early 20th century. And today this artificial idea is supported by the so-called collective West as an antipode to Russia. And unfairly defined national borders of Ukraine. According to Putin, native Russian territory, which is Donbass and the Azov Sea coast with the Black Sea region, was included into contemporary Ukraine by Lenin and the Bolsheviks. In doing so, we see a strange logic. On the other hand, Putin criticized Lenin and the communists that they allegedly gifted Soviet Ukraine inherently Russian territories. On the other hand, he praises the communist USSR, wants to restore it, and accuses Ukraine of decommunization. And the fourth main idea, Nazism is the main ideology of Ukraine. Propaganda has created the mythological picture. Nazi and fascist is a purely mythological concept. average Russians, soldiers, or average civilians don't figure out with term Nazism itself. What is the Nazism? For them, Nazism, like the Nazi, like the devils in medieval frescoes, or aliens in Ridley Scott films. Horrific, monstrous, non-human, about whom it was enough to know what they were once heroically defeated by the Russians in the Great War. Russians cannot be Nazis because they are Russian. It is axiom. Although their behavior sometimes looks like Nazi. And finally, Ukrainians are declared to be one people with Russians. Kremlin creates its reality and sincerely believes in it. And why and for what audience does this historical propaganda work? Look, propaganda does not exist in emptiness, in vacuum. It appeals to an already existing identities, attitudes, positions, views. This is called frames. Frames, Nazism is absolute evil. Russians and Ukrainians are similar people. Bandera is Nazi, have been forming by Soviet propaganda for ages. Some of them is true, some no, but they are all rooted in the brains of post-Soviet people. Contemporary Russia propaganda has just revived them. Even new inventions, symbolic inventions, are put in well-known context. St. George ribbon, as a symbol of patriotism, and of great victory, was invented in 2005, but it looks like guard ribbon of the period Second World War. It is symbolized with victory in the war, in this war. George ribbon. And the letter character Z is symbol of current Russia's aggression. It appeared spontaneously. It was not constructed on purpose. And at the first glance, letter Z doesn't fit any frames. It's an absolutely new symbol. At first, Z was one of several symbols painted of military vehicles of the Russian armed forces. It doesn't imply any association. It doesn't fit any frames. But this marking with Z became very common. It is drawn on every vehicle. Any military propaganda video camera catches with Z, this Z. It is impossible to show Russia's forces avoiding Z. And therefore, Russian propaganda began to use that as a symbol, including it in a familiar frame. За победу, for victory. Look, they take absolutely unknown symbol that with no one association, they take and put on this Z, very familiar colors and symbols. George ribbon symbols. And за победу, for victory. So unknown symbol turns into well-known context. And it works. Politics of memory in the occupied territory. In the occupied territory, the main narrative is that of so-called liberation. It seems absurd, But Russian occupiers call their aggression and occupation liberation, liberation from Ukrainian Nazism. Today, the invasion of Ukraine is presented as a fight against Ukrainian fascism, a repetition of Russian mission in 1941, 1945. And look, maybe Russian propaganda works using some technique from neuro-linguistic programming, framing and reframing. Liberation, liberation, reciberation. It's been repeated many times. It's been repeated many times. Its repetition is imprinted on people's brain, people under occupation. And people don't notice how they use this word, liberation. It becomes an axiom, a canon. The definition is subconsciously perceived. Even if someone, my friends, for instance, does not agree with this interpretation, they consider this action as occupation, but unconsciously, sometimes, talking to me, they talk the word liberation when they describe some events from everyday life. So, for instance, so when we met our uncle, it was after liberation or before liberation? Unconsciously. So the imposing of Russian official narrative, imposing Russian official narrative, and the destruction of Ukrainian one includes first changing the symbolic space, the streets and squares are being renamed to the old Soviet names, which were replaced in Ukraine during the process of decommunization. Restoring monuments to Lenin and other communist leaders, establishing new monuments to figure of Russian and Soviet history. For instance, monument to Alexander Nevsky in Mariupol, for example. Alexander Nevsky is the one of the main figure from a Russian historical pantheon. His image expresses fight collective West, strong and great power, Alexander Nevsky. They dismantle monuments to figures of Ukrainian history, destroy everything connected with Ukraine, all places of memory. Everything Ukrainian is declared wrong and hostile. Look, this monument was erected in honor Hetman Sahaidachny before large-scale aggression and Lenin. And now Russian occupies destroyed this monument because it is Ukrainian national place, site of memory, according to Pierre Nora, site of memory. So the Ukrainian education system is being eliminated and the Russian one is being introduced. We talked about it on our first session. Yes, it seems. Special attention to history. Ukrainian books are taken out of school and libraries to later be burned. This slide. To be burned, and methodological seminars are held for history teachers who remained to work under the occupation regime. They are told that they had wrong Bandera nationalist history, and now we will teach the correct Russian history. And of course, the cult of the great victory is being imposed. Nothing new. According to the same scenario, the politics of memory has been implemented since 2014 in the annexed Crimea and part of the Donbas. But some difference, there are some difference. Now this politics is much faster and tougher. All this suggests that there is a struggle for identity. Residents of the occupied territories are shown like, you are Russian. You are Russian. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Sergei, for this really, I don't know how to describe your presentation, disturbing facts that you are pointing out, but very insightful and very important for us to all discuss and think about together. So I invite our colleagues to raise your hand if you'd like to ask a question or make a comment, or you can also put your questions in the chat function and we can take them that way. Please, Maria, go ahead.
Thank you very much. I'm glad to see you all here. And really, your presentation was very, very interesting. But don't you see that today for Ukrainians, so that Ukrainians today are insensitive to such Russian propaganda? So, and such situation is not only the for last 2 years, but much earlier, maybe almost 10 years, no, 9 years since the start of the war in Donbas and Crimea annexion. I see such tendency on my friends, but people whom I know, that from Eastern Ukraine, from Southern Ukraine, that who before war, they were positively directed to on Russian culture, on Russian values, but after full-scale invasion, they don't want to hear anything about Russian propaganda, even Russian culture in general. So it's the case of academic curiosity, but not a threat for Ukrainians. We have, as for me, we have a very hard vaccination against such values. Don't you see this?
Thank you, Maria, for your question. First of all, and just remind you about my main topics. The first topic, the first stage of my presentation was how did history help to form current Putin Kremlin regime. The second point was how Russian historical narratives are upper-soft by citizen, by our citizen, under occupation. I mean citizen under occupation, Mariupol, etc., etc., etc. I didn't mean Ukrainians as well, Kharkiv and other eastern regions. I don't mean. And if you want to understand what people think under occupation, what people perceive under occupation, in what conditions they are living under occupation, you have to be there. But no. I wouldn't like to say that you have to come there. No. I mean people under occupation, people after siege, people after bombing and shelling, people who were starving and who were melting snow to water to drink. And of course, these people are disoriented. they don't get any information from Ukraine. Any information on from Ukraine. They get only Russian propaganda. They get only Russian propaganda. And the situation on the occupied territory is quite different in contrast to rest Ukraine. It's quite different. And I repeat, and I state that Russia propaganda works successfully under in occupied territories. I didn't observe perception of Russian propaganda in free Ukrainian lands, even Eastern Ukrainian.
Thank you, Sergii. Mariana, you have a question or a comment, please.
Hello, everyone. Thank you, Sergii, for your inspired and very thoughtful presentation. I'm quite agree with your opinion about this, the power of this persuasion, of this symbolic influence this symbolic figures, symbolic signs. So my question is how we should to solve this problem, what we can oppose this making of this similarity with Russian identity, and how we can resolve this situation, especially informing our foreign colleagues, historians, scientific community, ordinary people, citizens of other countries. What should you consider or offer for this?
Thank you, Mariana. It is a very crucial issue for our foreign politics as well, because our foreign partners and even allies often don't know about Ukraine anything, don't know about Ukrainian history. Ukraine has been in the shadow of Russian history for ages. And I see two direction to promote Ukrainian historical point of view. The first direction, constant popularization Ukrainian history through seminars, conferences, joint articles, meeting with students and with academic community, creating YouTube channels, using social media. Often our academic circle avoid this. They can consider this, oh, it is a scientific pop, nauk pop in Ukrainian, or gritsak, public intelligence. But gritsak, the gritsak is very successful in promotion Ukrainian points of view, very successful. Don't shy to be modern, to use social media, to create, please get skills to create animation, create comics maybe, to popularize, to provide Ukrainian historical narrative. And please, I assume that we have to distinguish our messages and our ideas according to foreign audience. If we are talking with audience from so-called global South, Brazil, Mexico, Africa, Asia, etc., arguments about democracy, European values, and human rights don't work. We have to use something like anti-colonial discourse. We have to come to them with the message. This is the message. Look, you fought colonial oppression, and we are fighting colonial oppression now. We are fighting for our independence, for our identity, like you several decades ago. So our diplomacy, our messages have to be distinguished and flexible.
Thank you, Sergii. Those are wonderful, wonderful ideas. We have a question in the chat that I will read out, and then our colleague Tatiana Saburova has a question. So Oleksiy Oleksyuk says, "Dear Sergii, I would prefer to understand the empirical background of all these conclusions. Is it possible to bring light to your historical data set, for example, sources and surveys that you used for this presentation?"
Yes, it is possible. It is possible. It is not just story for jargon, blah, blah, blah. I used theoretical studies on collective memory, on politics memory, and the specific researches about Russian politics of memory. I mentioned Koposov, Malinova, Kasyanov, Gritsak, Miller, if you want, Miller. And about politics of memory on occupied territory, please understand I can't discover these sources. These oral data and the sources of Telegram channels. The sources of Telegram channels. These Telegram channels, for instance, Nash Mariupol, if you want, Mariupol Navsigda, official Telegram channel of Mariupol State University, which remained under occupied authorities. But sorry, I can't to present you these data, which I got from my friends from occupied territories, from Russia. As for surveys, maybe it is understandable that there are not any physical possibility to conduct sociological surveys on occupied territories.
Thank you, Sergii. I see that Nadia has her hand up. I had seen earlier Tatiana's hand up. Tatiana, would you still like to ask a question?
Yes, thank you. Thank you, Sarah. Yeah, I didn't want to, you know, to hold my hand, being distracted. Yeah, thank you so much for your presentation. And I want to come back to the previous question about the possible ways, you know, to challenge this propaganda and kind of to make an effort to create resources to tell the Ukrainian history. I really appreciate your ideas that it definitely should be done more, including the public intellectual sphere, to talk about the Ukrainian history there, to make it this more available. Do you have in mind any examples, or you're just thinking about possible ways, or something has already been done to promote the Ukrainian history and to be available, like YouTube channels, comics, or any popular narratives that you have just mentioned? Thank you.
So I can list some YouTube channels popularized Ukrainian history. They were created by Ukrainian Institute of Culture or Ukrainian Culture Institute on the Ukrainian Institute of National Remembrance. I can name some public intelligences, intellectuals like Yaroslav Gritsak. I can mention the recent forum, Congress of Historians, which was held in Lithuania, Vilnius. A lot of historians are gathered there, including historians from Poland, Lithuania, the UK, and Ukraine. So I observe that this issue are solving now. This issue are solving now, but we have two, maybe three main obstacles. The first, we have to break the strong wall of Russian propaganda, of Russian historical points of view. And these points of view have been infecting Western academic community for ages. We have to overcome this. The second obstacle. So the more Ukrainian scientists, social scientists can speak English, the more influence can they provide. Unfortunately, I mean myself first of all, because my English is not fluent, but I try to cope with it. Unfortunately, majority of my colleagues from Mariupol University, they have to address to Western audience, but we can't speak English. It is our common problem in Ukraine. And the third obstacle, I don't know. Due to war, men are allowed to go abroad to take part in international conference and meetings, and via internet connection we can give our opinion to Western audience.
Yeah, thank you, Sergei. And may I ask just a brief following up question? In this case, what the target audience? Because you mentioned that, of course, all these resources and talks would be great to have them in English to reach the international audience. But in your presentation, you focused on the Russian audience and the Russian public being targeted by the Russian propaganda. Is it any way to fight this propaganda and address, I don't know, in Ukrainian, in Russian, in any other languages, and in general, what would be the target audience?
Okay. Don't underestimate the meaning of academic circles. academic circles in Europe or the USA influence political elites, political elites, and this influence can help us, political elite. As for average people, I don't know. As for average people, I don't know. You mentioned Russians. It is. I don't think any sense. I don't see any sense to try to influence, to impact Russian historical awareness. No, any sense. But I see sense in using Russian language in communication. Some of our patriots categorically reject using Russian language. But my personal experience proves that Russian language is effective tool of communication with audience in Moldova, in country of Central Asia, former Soviet Republic, in even in Baltic countries. To be honest, not every Ukrainian scientist know English language and every Lithuanian, Estonian, or Latvian scientist, or representative of civil society knows English language. We can enjoy it, or we can't enjoy it, but Russian language remains the effective tool of communication. And please, let's perceive it, Russian language, as a tool of communication. I don't see any problem, and I don't see any obstacles to use Russian language with foreign colleagues who knows Russian language and who speak Russian language.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. Yeah, thank you, Tatiana, for great questions as well, and great responses from Sergei. Nadia Honchorenko, your hand was up, and I see that you have shared a very interesting document with us in the chat. So please go ahead with your question or comment.
Yes. Okay. Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Sergei, for your presentation, for your paper, and I add the file to the chat. It's a newly presented analytical paper, which was presented in September this year. And it's very interesting paper about textbooks and war. And these authors, in some way, created this paper. They analyzed how history used as tool of destroying of Ukrainian identity, and I think we need to look through it. And I would like to add, Sergei, one deeper question to you. You mentioned Alexei Miller as analytics of Russian politics of memory. I think because, of course, he is academician, he is analytical, he wrote many books and articles, but at the same time, he one of the most prominent figure who created this Russian historical propaganda. So I think if we talking about him in the international audience, we need to emphasize this part of his identity, of his professional identity. What do you think about it?
Yes, of course, I agree. Mr. Miller have turned into Russian propagandist and provider of Russian official narrative. But we can use his previous works, 2011, 2012, and in these works we can see him as a very serious and solid analytic. As for his his current missions, let it be so, his current mission, yes, but of course we have to emphasize his propaganda mission, but we can use his article, we can study them, but for gain knowledge about propaganda from Russian academic circles, as just we can study his current works as works as propaganda. Is academic propaganda.
So thank you so much.
The question from Oleksiy Oleksiuk. he came back to statistical data, etc. Okay, let me explain.
Sure.
At our kick-off meeting, our previous colleagues, participators from this program, advised us, make your presentation more interesting, make your presentation more bright, also, etc., etc. I have some statistic data, some statistical links, but I didn't include them in my presentation. Maybe it was my mistake. I don't know.
So I'll remind everyone that we can continue the discussion in our Telegram channel. If you have joined, that's a wonderful place where we can continue. Maybe Sergii, you would like to share some of those data that you just mentioned. If you haven't signed up if you haven't joined the Telegram channel, the link should be somewhere in one of your organizational emails from Svetlana Melnik. If you're not able to find it, let us know. I'm afraid we have to wrap up now say thank you to Sergii for really your wonderful talk. Stimulated a lot of interest from our colleagues, lots of questions, lots of suggestions. So looking forward to seeing how this develops, and thank you so much for your presentation today.
Thank you for your attention. Thank you for your questions.